These are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon and welcome to the National Institute on Retirement Security's webinar on the Institute's latest research report, Pensions and Retirement Security 2013, a Roadmap for Policymakers. For your information, this webinar is being recorded and will be posted on our website following the webinar. Our agenda today is brief introductions of our speakers, a review of the report's methodology, a description of why NERS conducted this study, an overview of the key findings, and then we'll take your questions. Our speakers today are Diane Oakley, Executive Director of the National Institute on Retirement Security. Diane leads NERS's Organizational Research and Education Strategic Planning Initiatives. Before NERS, she was on Capitol Hill, and she also spent a number of years at Tia Kraff, a leading financial services firm. Also on the call today is Dr. Brian Perlman, partner and senior vice president with Matthew Greenwald and Associates. Brian directed the polling for this study, and we're very happy to have him work on this. He has more than 25 years leading strategic polls for a number of financial services organizations. Just a few words on the methodology for the study. It was a national telephone poll of 800 Americans aged 25 years or older as phone interviews. It was conducted from December 3rd to December 22nd, 2012. Once the polling results were received, the data was balanced to reflect U.S. demographics for age, gender, and income. The margin of error is plus or minus 3.5%. And you may notice as you thumb through the report, some of the pie charts may not have the numbers add up exactly to 100. That's because sums of two or more figures may not equal an expected total due to rounding. So if a pie chart adds up to 101 or 99%, it's because of rounding. And with that, I'll turn the presentation over to Diane Oakley, NERS Executive Director. Diane?
Thank you, Kelly. And thank you for your work on the study. I think it brings some valuable information into the public domain for individuals to understand where retirements are, where individuals are in terms of their views on retirement security. This is the third NERS nationwide public opinion research project that we've worked on with Matt Greenwald and Associates. We asked them to help us assess how the average American feels over time about retirement security and what are their views on policies that might be adopted to improve retirement prospects. We believe that the information provided in the report can be an important tool for policymakers, thought leaders, service providers, media, as you work to highlight issues in the retirement infrastructure and think about ways to improve it. What are the key findings? I think we've, in the last week or so, we've seen the market hit highs almost day after day, but Americans still remain very anxious. The actual survey, as Kelly indicated, was taken at the end of the year, so we didn't have the current market highs available. But I think what clearly comes across is the fact that the time that it took to get back to those highs in the market in 2007 have left Americans extremely anxious, even though they've seen stabilization and, in fact, upswings in the market since then. They're also dealing with declining unemployment, increased consumer confidence. What clearly happened with the financial market collapse or the near collapse was that sort of became the canary in the retirement security minefield. And individuals were made aware of some vulnerability that they seemed to have not quite understood that they had beforehand. In addition to that, one of the things that we found was that Americans were highly supportive of pensions, and they view them as a way to improve retirement readiness. Americans also have a sense that policymakers in Washington do not understand how hard it is to struggle to save for retirement. They would overwhelmingly support congressional action to provide a new privately pension-run pension plan for all Americans. Millennials are our youngest members of the workforce, are highly dissatisfied with the state of retirement security for them and what they see going forward. And they're equally dissatisfied with regard to policymaker efforts to address their concerns. We clearly see, and this is something we've seen throughout the periods that we've done the study, that Social Security benefits are something that the public views to remain important, and especially as we're in the midst of a budget debate looking at entitlement spending and cuts to entitlement spending, their views on that are clearly that Social Security benefits remain important. Americans support public employee pensions. We have some data on that this time that's an interesting addition to the survey. And in addition to that, Americans understand the economic imperative to ensure that employees have sufficient income to retire and how that will impact our economy going forward and even impacts it today. Of course, the most interesting thing is to really get a sense on how people are feeling. And so we do ask an open-ended question. And before we get into the details of the findings, I just want to share with you some of the personal statements that individuals gave us when we asked them, what was the biggest challenge to achieving a secure financial future? Finding a job with a good retirement plan was one suggested by an individual. Being able to save enough money with low interest rates and returns on investments in the real estate market and declining home values, all of those type of concerns that people have seen in the last couple of years. Well, I think that with me somehow not being resourceful enough to have information I needed, one needs to plan for retirement. You need to consider the amount of money you'll need in order to plan properly. Another individual said, I don't see retirement at all. One other individual was still concerned about the losses that they had. We lost quite a bit of money in my IRAs as the banks went down, and we lost $60,000. And my husband also had Alzheimer's. In addition to that, things were good, and now increases in my Social Security do not keep up with inflation. I am worried about Social Security, Medicare, the tax structure, and how that is going to affect my ability to save. So Americans are worried, they're still concerned. And Brian, I'm going to turn it over to you to go through the statistics in terms of what we saw in terms of the numbers from the survey. Thank you.
Okay, sure. Thank you, Diane. First of all, I'd like to say, Diane, that I do a bazillion focus groups, and I've seen those comments over and over and over again in different shades, but those are clearly out there. So the first point that objective of the study was to look at how people feel about their retirement. And what we see is there's a high level of concern about economic conditions affecting people's ability to achieve a secure retirement. These numbers are really high, 55% very concerned, 30% somewhat concerned, and only 15%, 14% not concerned. Those are very high numbers. And if the trend we're seeing everywhere in the Retirement Confidence Survey, certainly we're seeing over the last several years, confidence in the ability to achieve a secure retirement had hit a low, and it's been at that low for a few years now. And it's not surprising. I think a few of the things that are affecting this are, first of all, people are still a little skittish about the markets, even though they've come back. And also, you couple that with low interest rates that makes it very hard to leverage anything you've saved in order to provide yourself with an income in retirement. And so all that translates into what I consider, and I see a lot of survey data, but to me, this is a really high level of concern, of anxiety about the ability to achieve a secure retirement. And furthermore, what we see is that this anxiety has been steady over the last few years, and not significantly so, but on the very concerned side, it even seems to have gone up slightly over the last 4 years. And be curious to see what the next trend brings, but certainly there's no sign of this anxiety dissipating given current economic events. And that's interesting too, because if you think about it, when we did this in 2009, we were at the peak of the housing and market crash. And despite the fact that the stock market's doubled since then, well, a little earlier than 2009, it was actually the peak. But even so, since 2009, stock market's probably gone up maybe 70 or 80%. And we're still seeing this level of anxiety, which is really interesting. We do see a high support for pensions. We see that 83% have a favorable view of pensions, which again is an extremely high number. And again, this suggests that most people in these economic times see pensions as a very positive thing. one of the ways we looked at this, and we asked people, let's say you were taking a new job and considering two employers, one that offered a pension, the other a 401k, how likely would you be able, would you be to choose the employer with the pension? What we see is about 45% say the pension versus, or at least somewhat more likely to choose the employer with the pension, only 27% the employer with the 401k. Now, this is interesting, and you know, to some extent, there is this element of people associate pensions with being funded by the employer, and that has some impact. But we asked not this question, but questions like it 5 and 10 years ago when 401ks were doing double-digit returns. And what we saw back then was that people were actually counting more on the 401k than the pension, and people actually had this attitude of, well, I'd really like to have the money in my hands to take care of and invest myself. Again, different questions in this, but that trend was out there about 5 or 10 years ago. And looking at this data, it certainly suggests that is not going to be the prevailing attitudes anymore. That clearly people lean more towards the pension side. Now, Greenwald does different American Dream questions. We've done it for college education. We've done it for other things. American Dream is really a powerful icon, and it's one that we like to ask, because when someone says that they're taking away the American Dream, that's a highly emotional-laden statement. And so when you can associate something with the American Dream, it has really strong implications. And what we see is that 80% agree that the disappearance of pensions has made it harder for workers to achieve the American Dream. And what really blew me away is that 47% believe this strongly. And so quite clearly, people associate pensions with something very important to our society. And this certainly shows that the disappearance of pensions is a big issue to people. We then got into more policy-related issues, and we asked, to what extent do you agree or disagree that leaders in Washington should give a higher priority to ensure Americans can save for a secure retirement? What we see is 62% strongly agree, 24% somewhat agree, 86% agree overall. And I was talking to Diane and Kelly about this. This is really interesting, because we just had an election. We know we have a polarized country. We know we have 48% who voted for a Republican nominee for president. We also know we have a Tea Party, and we know we have a lot of people who believe the government should stay out of people's lives. Granted that, you know, if you ask them about Social Security, they ask give you a different opinion. But nonetheless, the fact that 86% want Washington to get involved in people's efforts for retirement is a powerful statement, because I don't think we have the political consensus in our country to achieve a result like this, unless the issue is a really strong issue. And this, again, is really strong data about what Washington should do. We asked about, to what extent do you agree that the system needs reform? And this is really interesting, because it's not just the level of people who agree, but it's been the change in the last couple of years. We've gone up 9 points in the percentage of people who think that the pension system needs reform. And to me, that's a very large jump. And again, this is occurring at a time between 2011 and 2013 when the stock market has gone up. Interest rates are still, of course, incredibly low and hard to live off of. But certainly the market climate would suggest that things are more positive. But nonetheless, we see an increase in the people who believe that the system is under stress. And that it needs reform. And some of this could be some of the political debate that's been going on, certainly. And certainly, as Senator Harkin would say, you know, we don't have a budget crisis, we have a retirement crisis. And this slide is very, very consistent with that some of the whole debt issues we're facing are related to the health and income in retirement. And this slide certainly supports that, and that system does need reform. Now, this next statement is basically an idea for a bill, Senator Harkin's bill. It, basically, we put this up there because this is the exact language that the respondents got. And I won't read the statement to you, but you can look it over. But as they were doing the survey, they got this statement and read this statement and asked their were asked for their opinion of it. And basically, the statement tells you a few things about the privately run pension system. They talk about it being professionally managed, people getting a lifetime check, and the system being portable. Also the idea that it would be easy for employers to administer because they wouldn't be responsible for administering it. Anyway, so those were the things they were told, and they were asked their views on this. Overall, 75% show support for the new system. 25% think it's a very good idea. 49% say it's a pretty good idea. Only 25% say it's a bad idea. Oh, I'm sorry, the 5% don't know. Really, only 20% say it's a bad idea. Now, we oftentimes, one of the tricks of survey research is to kind of get a sense of what the scale somewhat or pretty good idea means. Sometimes, like if people are somewhat knowledgeable, we sort of say they don't know very much. But when people say something's a pretty good idea, when they've had like 4 seconds or so to read it and then react to it, and you can't expect them to fall in love with it just on a first read. To me, the pretty good idea slide is still a very positive thing. So for me, I see this as being a very high level of support for this idea. We asked how likely people would be to participate in such a system if offered. And again, very, very high. 40% very likely, 41% somewhat likely. And I think this was a first impression that they got from reading a statement. And to me, that means the somewhats are still people who had a positive reaction to the idea. So a large majority of people would actually consider taking part in something like this. And given the data we've seen on the pension in the past, in the earlier slides, about the pension system needing reform, about people having anxiety, it really tells a coherent story. And I think it's not surprising that people want something that will help them secure a more predictable future in their retirements. We asked people what aspects of this plan, how appealing they found various aspects of the plan. And if you went back to the statement, you would see each one of these in that statement. And what we see as the highest is the portability. 73% find the portability very appealing. And portability has been an issue, certainly when you talk about teachers who switch jobs and things like that. But this idea that you can take it from job to job and it doesn't matter where you go is really the most appealing aspect of this. But also having the monthly check, which is available from other kinds of systems, and being available to everybody, which are the real hallmarks of this program, are all received very favorably. I mean, the private sector solution and auto enrollment is also fairly appealing, but in particular the portability and the monthly check are things that people find very appealing. It's interesting, we do a lot of work in private annuities, and there's been a real resistance for people taking their money and turning it into a lifetime annuity. But one of the things employers and some companies have done to try to encourage it has been to call it a private pension plan. And that's, as far as we know, has been one of the most flattering ways to describe an annuity. And I think that sort of suggests why this idea of getting yourself, being able to buy into a pension system is a very appealing idea to people. We also did some work with millennials. Now, let me say something, that all these scales, everybody has very high opinions about a lot of these scales. The millennials tend to be higher than other people, sometimes significantly so, sometimes almost significantly so, but the millennials had the highest ratings on a lot of these. This does not suggest we didn't find high ratings with other groups as well, but millennials were higher. And you do see that millennials do have higher concern about the economic situation. They are in favor of Congress doing a bill to provide some kind of pension plan. And they do want they agree the government should make it easier for employers. They also more strongly agree that leaders in Washington don't understand how hard it is to prepare for retirement and feel the system's under stress. And this is not surprising. We see certainly with millennials and not being certain about the future of Social Security for them, whereas older people tend to know Social Security is around the corner for them, that the millennials more than other groups tend to have more concerns about what's going to happen to them with the retirement system. And not surprising, if particularly these people who have gotten into the job market, given the condition of the markets in the last few years. People still think that protecting Social Security is strong, and basically ask people, do they agree the government should cut spending, even if it means reducing Social Security? And what you see is 45% strongly and two-thirds at least somewhat disagree. Typically when we do survey research and we flip the scales like this where the disagree is the stronger reaction, people don't tend to disagree with things as much as they agree with things. It's just a quirk of survey research. So the fact that we got 67% disagreeing with the statement to me is a strong sense that people do not want to see any kind of reduction in Social Security benefits. And it's interesting because certainly there's been thoughts put on the table about this in recent years, in recent months, and we've heard about cutting or changing how inflation's calculated and things like that for Social Security. We've heard people say that entitlements are really costly and we have to do something about them, but it doesn't seem to trickle down to people thinking you should do something with Social Security. We do see that there's strong support for public pension systems because employees pay for them, and we see 73% agree with this statement, 33% strongly agree, 39% somewhat agree with the statement. I think what's happened, what I've seen in this survey, we certainly have the concept of pension envy, where some people wonder if people are going to resent state employees and teachers because they get pensions and a lot of private sector workers don't. But we don't see that. And one of the things I've also seen is I think that the budget discussions in Washington and the broken nature of the federal government has really taken a lot of focus off of the state level and what's happening to the financial situation in the states. And I think this is taken some emphasis off of the cost of pensions at the state level in particular. That's one of the things I've noticed out there in our research. Americans do want pensions for all, and they do believe everybody ought to have a pension. And there's a lot of strong agreement with the statement. And again, this is just consistent with everything we've seen, that there is support for the pension system. And not just that I want a pension, but that in the current environment that people should have a pension. And to me, this logically falls into place with everything else we've been talking about, because I do think that a lot of people are beginning to understand after what the markets did in the last 5 years and after where interest rates are today, that it's not so easy for people to do it themselves. I think 10 years ago, and I've used this analogy in the talk I gave at the conference, when you had Peter Lynch talking from Fidelity talking about 16 baggers, where people can put in $100 and have it turn into $1,600 in 10 or 15 years, particularly in his Fidelity Magellan Fund, those days don't see well. They have been there a little recently, but for the most part, those days seem to be gone. And so I think that people understand that it's really hard to do it yourself, given all the vagaries and uncertainties of the markets. We asked people to what extent that they agree that increasing the number of boomers retiring without adequate savings is putting stress on families and the economy. And we see very strong numbers on these as well. We see 87% who at least somewhat agree, 51% who strongly agree. And this to me suggests, again, that we have an issue with retirement security and that certainly people recognize it and recognize the challenges that baby boomers are going through. And it isn't just the lack of money, but it's the belief that the baby boomers are really the first generation who have seen the decline of the pension system. The generation before them have not. And to a large extent, this is seen as something that's putting stress on families and the economy. And it's a fairly big issue to people.
And I think with that, we'll conclude Brian's presentation and we'll take your questions. Just as a reminder to folks who may not have been on our webinars in the past, you can type a question into the question box. We'd also be happy to take your questions over the phone line. You just need to type in a question, please unmute my phone line, and I can open up your phone line and you can ask the question over the telephone. So it looks like we have a couple questions in the queue, and I'm going to read those aloud so that Brian and Diane can answer those. Just bear with me for 1 second and I'll pull up those questions. Okay, the first question, Brian and Diane, could you be seeing this anxiety because most folks don't have the money to replace what they've lost or don't have a job with a sustainable wage and benefits?
It's one of several factors. And I think part of what I've seen over the last 5 or 10 years in focus groups is that I saw a lot of people getting out of the market and being afraid to get in. And they're first now getting the courage to go back in the market when the market's at 14,000, which is kind of a real big problem. But yes, you do certainly have the fear of job loss. You have the actual job loss. Are factors that are certainly coupled with how hard it is. And if you think about it, people have to have the money to put away, which is hard to do when you have uncertainty about your job. They need to be able to manage the money financially, which is really hard to do when the stock market is going crazy and interest rates can't produce an income when you hit retirement. Those are certainly all big issues. And I think even though the market has come back, that there's a residual group of people who are kind of freaked out about a lot of this. And so that's still out there.
Let me just add to that. You know, Brian, at the conference that we did just 2 weeks ago, one of the things we looked at in terms of this was a couple things. In the survey, I believe, we did ask people what was making retirement harder for them to be able to achieve a secure retirement. And clearly, one of the issues was the fact that their salaries had not been keeping pace with inflation. Another factor cited by nearly 90% of the individuals responding was that there were fewer pensions out there for them to take advantage of. So I think there's those two things. And then when you look at the data, we looked at data that recently came out of the Federal Reserve Survey of Consumer Financing. And that data showed that less than 12%, for example, of households within 10 years of retirement had more than four times their salary put away to retire. And in fact, the largest number of households, the largest percentage, had actually less than one times their salary saved. And those people are only, you know, within 10 years of retirement. So I think it's absolutely true that people are feeling their ability of preparing for retirement security.
Yeah, we actually, retirement confidence last year showed about 21% had more than $100,000 in their 401ks.
But actually the median is much less than that. The median, which is where half of the people are, is about 60.
Thank you. And I would just, this is Kelly, I just refer everyone to figure 7 on page 8 of the report. There's a chart that shows which you believe is a major or minor factor in making it hard for Americans to prepare for retirement. And it shows salaries, fewer pensions, and longer lives in that data chart. Our next question is an easy one that I can take. How are you defining millennials? And for the purposes of this study, we define millennials for those born after 1976. And if you look on page 22 of the report, under the methodology, you can see millennials were 1976. Gen X is 65 to 76. Boomers are 46 to 64. 1946 to 1964, and then the silent generation is 19 46 born before that date. So that's how we broke out those different age groups. Another question we have, how can we use this in our publication and media contacts? I can take a stab at that again. This is Kelly. All of our reports are, we encourage people to cite them in your publications, newsletters, press releases. I think the more that we are able to disseminate this information to audiences on the national and the state and local level, I think, you know, the more that that will help in terms of building awareness of these issues. For those of you who are on the call who are members of NERS, if you can access the NERS members only website, we've developed some content that will enable you to put short summaries of the research into your newsletters or provide all the charts to any stakeholders that you may have on the local level or on the national level also, that will be helpful to communicate the results of this poll as well.
So one other thing I'll just add, this is Diane. We just also did something a little bit differently this year too. There will be on the NERS website with our information, a whole file of all of the graphics. I think as you look at the numbers when they're graphed, as opposed to just saying something and being able to see how many feel strongly and not so strongly on those where we have trend lines, that's really powerful information. All of those charts are available on our website and they're there so that you can just take up that JPEG file and put it into a publication and use it. And I think there was a later question coming about, are you going to be tweeting and using social media to get this information out? And the answer to that is yes, we're developing a strategy to start doing a tweet every so often on some of the different charts with highlights and links back to that information.
Yeah. And we've been pushing information about the NERS conference as well as this report out on our Facebook and Twitter pages for those of you who are following NERS. If you're not, we encourage you to do so. And we will continue to push that information regarding the study through those tools also. We have another question. How did you account for political affiliations? I can take a stab at that, Brian. I don't know if you want to weigh in, but we did, you know, we did ask people in the survey what their political affiliation was. Democrat, Republican, or independent, I believe, was the way we broke it out.
Correct.
We didn't provide any, honestly, we didn't really look at like that analysis when we did this, although we had the data available because we were trying to keep this very apolitical, just in terms of the findings. We wanted to put it out there what Americans were feeling broadly without layering on top of that sort of heated political discussions that are going on in the country. Brian, did you have anything else to add to that?
No, I mean, we didn't. We for the purposes of this study, we have that data, and it's in our tab books. We haven't really analyzed it. I did glance at it, and I do think that there's more Democratic support for the government actions, but I'd have to really double check that.
Yeah, and if it is,
but it's there. The data, we actually can look at that data.
Yeah, and if anyone's interested, you know, certainly give us a call or send us an email, and we can pull that and take a closer look at it. We just
right. I, you know, for every question, we have a breakdown of how the variations were with regard to political affiliation.
Just give me a second. One, did you account for education level in the polling? And we did not account for education level in the polling, if I'm not mistaken. Correct, Brian?
Correct.
Okay.
Although we do account, we do have breakouts by age.
We have breakouts by education, yes.
By age, by income level too, as well. So there are various ways that we can break down the data if someone's interested. If we break it down to too narrow of a band, however, the validity of that data. So it's probably good to, and Brian, maybe you want to comment on that. If we look at like male and female, where there's a good distribution, that's pretty reliable, I would say, on a national level. But when we get down to maybe some of the age-specific millennials and things like that, it may not be as much of a point where you could say this is totally national and reliable to the same.
I think it's pretty close. I don't think it's that far off on that, particularly on the age side. We tend to get more educated people with polling just because they respond higher to surveys. But the income, but the age is not that far off.
Our next question, do you have any suggestions on how to combat the issue of quote-unquote pension envy? This is Kelly. I can sort of kick that response off. I'm sure everyone's aware that there's been a fair amount of discussion amongst a wide variety of groups, and some of it we've also seen in the news media about the private sector envying the pension benefits that the public sector has. The level of coverage for private sector workers, as we all know, has been on the decline, while the level of pension benefits for public sector workers has remained consistent in, like, I guess, the 90% levels. And I guess it's sort of out there in the public domain that the private sector envies and sort of wants to take away the benefits that the public sector has. And I think the polling data that we found is very compelling that that, in fact, is not the case, that perhaps what we're seeing is that the private sector envies what the public sector has because they want it, not because they want to take it away from the public sector. I did look that at that really specifically in some of the polling questions. We did break out the folks that we interviewed, whether they work for the public sector, the private sector, or another sort of nonprofit other entity. And it was really striking that it was the 80% level support pensions from public sector workers, which isn't surprising, but also we saw that really high level of support for public sector workers from private sector workers at that 80% and up level as well. So it was consistent that the public sector supports public pensions and the private sector supported public sector pensions. And I'll just reference one article that I read in the National Journal several years ago that I think sort of encapsulates what's going on. It's not so much that the private sector wants to take away what the public sector has. It's not that the public sector has too much, it's that the private sector workers have too little pensions. They have too little retirement security, and that's really the heart of the issue. So I think this data is very, very important in sort of refuting that pension envy debate and trying to figure out a way that we can provide all Americans with retirement security.
Now, Diane, let me tell you another trend. So let me mention another trend that I see going on with that, which is part of pension envy has been focused in recent years about how budgets are going broke trying to pay for pensions. And that still is out there, but what's happened, and I've been doing a lot of research, and every time I conduct a focus group, the thing that's really hitting as far as what's causing our problems is dysfunction in Washington. When it comes to any sort of a political or social issue that's affecting people's ability to have or affecting the economy, that's what it's been. The belief that our economy can't get started because the leaders can't get together, that has sucked so much of the oxygen out of the room for any other government-related issue that it's really dominated the debate. And I think that's had an effect on people not focusing on funding pensions like they used to do.
And this is Kelly, just another comment about the public sector pensions. I think there's a growing awareness that public sector workers do contribute to their pension benefits, and that while there are a few outlier states that have some funding issues, the vast majority of public pension systems are doing a good job of recovering from the economic crisis, and they are pre-funded at pretty high levels. And it's not sort of the crisis that is sort of out there in some discussions.
And maybe just to close it down a little bit, but I think, you know, when you think about it, the basic underlying scenario with regard to envy is anxiety. And so clearly we know Americans are anxious. And it really is interesting in our survey what comes out of their anxiousness when you're not giving them a plate that directs them in one way and you're just saying, here's some opportunities. For example, I think the reactions to the survey questions about that new plan, very interesting that the concept of portability and the concept of getting a plan that has a monthly check ranked basically with the same 90% level plus level of support. So I think what we're really hearing is individuals want some of that type of protection that they see in a type of pension plan. Kelly, I think there's another question here about millennials.
Another question. It surprises me that millennials are so cognizant of retirement issues. I didn't think that was true in the past from my experience. Is this a new phenomenon? That's an excellent question. When I first read the polling results and was drilling down into the age brackets, I was also equally surprised. I mean, I don't look at this data the way that Brian does on a regular basis, but it was really surprising to me. And that's quite frankly the reason we pulled it out, this generation, for the polling findings, because just individuals who are so far away from retirement and so anxious and so distressed, it seemed to me to be a new phenomenon. Brian, I don't know if you want to comment on that just in your long history of looking at this sort of data.
I do think that there certainly is that concern among the millennials. You know, it's hard to say, and I will put on my psychologist hat now, but what we ask the millennials are more what we call attitudinal questions. And I think it's hard to read from these questions how much emotion the millennials actually have about the issues. I'm not saying one way or the other. And these statements that we're giving them tend to be more belief statements. And I think when you look at millennials and ask what they believe, certainly I think they believe things going to be very challenging for them given the situation they're in. It's hard to gauge the strength. I'm not saying it's high or low. It's hard to gauge the strength of the emotion behind those attitudes.
Yeah. Brian, the other thing, and I'm going to do this more from an anecdotal point of view, because I've certainly been speaking in places where I've seen a lot of millennials a couple of times on radios and the newscasts that I've done. And when you talk to them about retirement, there really is a level of awareness. I wonder, you know, I think you've got a generation. Just yesterday, I was in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, at a public radio station, and the young gentleman who walked me out, I was talking to him a little bit. We were talking about student loans, and his comment to me was, I've got over $100,000 in student loans, and I'm not a doctor. And he, you know, I think they're looking at paying off their loans. They're also looking at trying to start to save for retirement, because I think our financial education is making some inroads and helping them understand that it's important to save. We've got new tools out there like auto enrollment that brings them into plans earlier, hopefully. But I think I think they are more cognizant of retirement. I think they're aware of it. I've also heard in some of my conversations where you'll hear a young person say, you know, I'm really concerned about my mom. You know, she only has a 401k plan that has $25,000 in it and Social Security. So I think that, and you know, that question about understanding the implications of retirement security on family and society is something that those millennials do seem to get. So I think that's...
Yeah. Now, they do get a lot. And one of the things I've been seeing, too, is it's not just the millennials' anxieties, but it's the... And I didn't say that they're not... They aren't concerned. From the data, we get a sense that they're very cognizant of the issues. I do get a sense in other research we do, particularly when you look at the parents of millennials, that one of the biggest issues they have right now is they're really concerned about their kids being able to make it in the world, and between debt and finding a job and all that, that the economic anxiety, certainly with the millennials and with their parents, is very high out there.
Mm-hmm. Well, it looks like we're out of questions, and we thank you all so much for joining us today. Just as a reminder, this webinar will be available on a replay on our website later today, or certainly by Monday morning. The report and all the information contained in the report is available on our website, www.neurosonline.org. You'll also find a link to the Washington Post story about the report, which we were thrilled to have in the Washington Post, and you know, any exposure we get to these issues is certainly helpful to improving retirement security for Americans. So we thank Brian for being on the call, and Diane. And if anyone has any questions or comments, please don't hesitate to call us, 202-457-8190. And have a good afternoon and a lovely weekend. Thank you.
Thanks, bye.